Someone asked me a really good question. So I said in a video that for policy issues, people should trust peer-reviewed research using rigid empirical methods. And those influencer types like Chomsky don't conduct that kind of research, and therefore they aren't able to make causal inference between policies and outcomes. So this gentleman asked me how political scientists are even able to conduct empirical research given low sample sizes and numerous confounding variables in the political world. For example, when the US conducts an intervention in another country, it's like a one-time thing. No similar cases elsewhere. So only two data points, before and after. So how can we possibly know if the outcome is caused by that policy or some other thousands of events that also happen at the same time? That's a really good question. So quantitative methods are definitely more difficult in political science than in other disciplines. But there are a few ways around it. Firstly, not every question has a small sample size. For example, I mentioned in that video how the cut of the USAID will cause millions of deaths. That is not controversial at all. The paper I cited was not even published in a political science journal. It was in a medical journal. It was public health scholars who compared a large group of countries with and without aid, before and after aid. So the sample size was pretty decent. Of course, there are also other studies that use local level or even individual level data, which means even larger samples. Large data sets are not uncommon these days in political science, okay? So in the old days, it was hard. You can't find data analysis in the Federalist Papers or something because, you know, there was no data. But today, if you want to study patterns in electoral systems, you can find hundreds, if not more than 1,000 national elections around the world to compare with, let alone local elections or even individual level exit polls. So many numbers you can play with. Even the sample size for war is not that small. Well, these days there aren't many wars, maybe a handful a year, but that small number can actually tell you a lot if you compare it with the large number of wars in the past. If you look at any country's history before World War II, you will find that they are almost always in some kind of war, nonstop. And that nonstop conflict lasted thousands of years. So if you build a panel data with one country, 1 year as a data point, there are a lot of data points. I don't have any paper off the top of my head, but you can easily see that the number of wars plummeted after the World War II and dropped even further after the Cold War. But of course, that's just the dependent variable. What about independent variables? So in the same video, I mentioned that NATO was a necessary condition for the post-war peace. But of course, so many things changed after World War II. So how can I possibly make the claim that it was NATO, not other variables? You know, maybe this guy's fever was about to go away anyway, so the pills he took had nothing to do with it. Well, in that case, we just have to exclude other confounding variables one by one. Say, some people prefer a psychological explanation, saying that after World War II, countries simply lost the appetite for war. That can be easily proved wrong. The Korean War happened right after World War II, involving 22 countries, all of which had been worn out during World War II. The first Arab-Israeli War happened right after World War II, right, involving 7 countries, including that one country made up of World War II refugees. Also, the Chinese Civil War. It started before World War II, paused for a while to fight Japan, and then after World War II, they picked up right where they had left and kept going. A few more millions died. So the war appetite seemed just fine. I talked about more cases in this video. You can check it out. So the appetite argument just doesn't work, empirically or theoretically. Especially Comrade Stalin. He's not the kind of man who's concerned with trivial things like casualties. So you need more than psychological explanations for a post-World War II peace. Another confounding variable is nukes. Some people say, oh, nuclear deterrence makes countries afraid of fighting each other. That doesn't make sense either. If nukes are so powerful, it should make nuclear countries even more likely to invade non-nuclear countries, right? Why not? You have this thing the other side is so scared of. That means you can make whatever territorial demand you want, right? Most European countries don't have nukes at all. So how come Stalin didn't march into their capitals? See? Ultimately, it's NATO. Not a single NATO country has been invaded with or without nukes. That's a pretty obvious empirical pattern. The sample size is big enough. Plus, nukes aren't as scary as you think, because the political cost for a government to use nukes is very, very high. Remember Vietnam first fought a nuclear country, the United States, and won. Then a few years later, it fought another nuclear country, China, and won again. Well, sort of. At least China wasn't able to keep any occupied territory. Afghanistan fought a nuclear power, the Soviet Union, and won. And then recently, Afghanistan under Taliban fought a long war with the United States, and guess what? Won again. That's at least four cases of non-nuclear countries beating nuclear countries. Why? Because they knew the other side wouldn't dare using nukes. I can't go into more detail today, but the bottom line is, when there are a lot of confounding variables, it is possible to get rid of them one by one using common sense logic. It will never be 100% convincing, of course, but you can reach a pretty high level of confidence. And there are also other statistical tools to exclude confounding variables, like, you know, instrumental variables, like fixed effects. You know, I don't think I remember them well enough to talk about them, but there are plenty of ways to do it. Okay, of course, there are always individual cases where empirical methods will never be enough. Say, people largely believe the Iraq war was a failure. But it's actually kind of hard to verify, because we don't know the counterfactual. What would have happened if Saddam Hussein had been president this whole time? Many people claim they know, but that's not very scientific. How can you? We don't know because it's a single data point that we have nothing to compare with. One way is to compare Iraq before and after Saddam. But how long before and how long after? Right? What about the confounding variables that happened in between, like the Arab Spring? Right? Could the Syrian Civil War have contributed to some outcomes in Iraq? I don't think we can ever answer a question like this, given the lack of similar cases. If you want to enlarge the sample by including more countries, you're going to bump into a lot more confounding variables like geography, political systems, ethnic groups, etc. So yes, unfortunately, there are a lot of political questions that we probably won't be able to answer, like ever. But there are also a lot that we can answer. The effectiveness of USAID is definitely one of them. The effectiveness of NATO is another one. And there are many others. Okay, well, I think I just covered what a typical research design class would cover in 4 weeks. Pretty nice, right?